Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. I'm Nancy Begranoff, the Dean of the Robbins School. And welcome to our speaker, a session with Jim Glassman. I have to tell you that we plan our speakers usually a year in advance. We work really hard. We think of speakers we can have. And then occasionally, a great speaker sort of drops into our lap. And that's exactly what happened today. We were so excited when we heard that we would have the opportunity to have Jim Glassman here. So we're very appreciative to George Albright and to Scott Head and to JPMorgan for allowing us to have this wonderful session. So we're about to hear from senior economist Jim Glassman, the managing director and senior economist for JPMorgan Chase. He has lots of degrees, as you might imagine, a bachelor's degree from the University of Illinois, a master's degree in economics, good for a chief economist, from the University of Illinois, and a PhD in economics from Northwestern University. He was just mentioning that when he graduated with his PhD, he could have gone into academe or he could go to the Federal Reserve, and he chose the Federal Reserve. So from 1979 to 1988, he was a senior economist in the Research and Statistics and Monetary Affairs Departments at the Federal Reserve Board in Washington, D.C. His responsibilities range from analysis and forecasting of inflation and labor market developments, kind of two things that the Fed does, to analysis of the Federal Reserve's operating strategies and interest rate markets, to development of monetary and reserves projections. He joined Morgan Guaranty in 1988, then Chemical Bank in 1993, and through a combination of mergers, became JPMorgan Chase & Company. Please welcome Jim Glassman.
Thank you. You know, what I'm going to do is I want to talk about a topic that it gets a lot of, there's a lot of confusion about it and about what the Fed is doing. And then I'll give you a quick rundown on how we view what's going on globally. The world's gotten very small and we're all very connected, so it matters what's happening in Europe and it matters what's happening in Japan. And then I'll cover a little bit of what I think is key for about the U.S. and where we are in the U.S. recovery, and how we economists tend to think about how it is that we follow the economy, what we look for, and what do we do in a bank, and then just a couple comments on the challenges we still face. So you folks you're going to be graduating 2014, 15, 16, 17, right? Life is going to look a lot better for you than it has for anybody who graduated in the class of 2008, 2009, 2010, 2011. It's been brutal. It's been very brutal, and you know how you see it. If you look at all of us by age, the younger you are, the fewer of you have a job relative to where we were back in 2007 before the recession. And that's a very unique, I've never seen anything quite like this. And it tells you something about the world that we're living in right now and how things have been transforming. It used to be in the old days when we go into recessions, companies get into trouble, they're working hard to cut costs. And what happens is the older folks got pushed out because they're expensive. And people coming out of college had a pretty good shot at getting a job. There were maybe more inexperienced, but they were less expensive. What's going on now is completely opposite. It's completely opposite, and it tells you a little bit about what's going on. When we go through a very difficult time and companies have to survive, you tend to want to hang on to the people who have the skills and the experience, and if you're coming out of college and you don't have that, you're at a disadvantage. And it's partly the severity of the crisis that we went through. It's partly because a lot of innovation has been taking place over the last 15 years. It's displaced an awful lot of jobs that used to be done that didn't take a lot of skills. And the world is getting very competitive. We've got all kinds of new competition all around us. A lot of workers that want to go to work, and the world isn't quite enough demand for everybody yet, and it's creating a lot of stress. But honestly, the winds are changing. And we're on the way. We're climbing out of a deep hole that we got into. In my reckoning, and I'll try to show you a couple visuals to make this point. In my reckoning, we're probably in the fifth inning of the recovery from the recession that hit us severely in 2008. And that means we still have quite a bit of work to do to get the country back to full employment. And fortunately, inflation is very low, which gives the Federal Reserve lots of leeway. It's one of the reasons why they are willing to do unusual things that they're doing right now. But you know, until now, a lot of the job growth has been taking place for people who had jobs in the last, you know, earlier. They lost them, they got on unemployment insurance, and an awful lot of the job growth that we've been getting has been people who had the experience, they were unemployed. And what that means is that people coming out of college didn't have as much of a shot because you're competing with people who had some experience. But now you're starting to see things change. Now it seems like each class, this year's class had a little better time than the class before them. So by the time you're there, my guess is it's going to feel a little different than your predecessors. And I'm kind of an expert in the class of 2008 myself, because I have a daughter who's graduated, and she and all her friends, I'm kind of plugged into what that generation is doing, because for part of my job as an economist, on Sunday night, I do a telephone broadcast for all of my partners, my colleagues, on what it was that we learned in the last week, all that news, and what we're looking for in the week ahead. And it's kind of a short-term focus on the issues that we're thinking about. My daughter's been hearing me do this ever since she was in kindergarten. So she has this idea that whatever happens in the economy is my call. So you know, she knows better now, but because of that, she and all her friends, whenever there's something bad going on, whenever there's a story about what's happening to the class of 2008, I get a bunch of emails about what's happening. So I've learned, you know, what are people doing? They've kind of dropped out. Some of them have gone back to school. Some are working for NGOs in Nairobi. Some are teaching in Thailand. But I think, you know, from my point of view, I think what young people are facing is actually a healthy thing, because nothing is certain in life. And you know, you guys have been working hard all your life to get to where you are right now. And you've probably had this idea that all you got to do is get that degree, and then the doors open up and the jobs are there. It's not always true. And that's what, there's a whole generation, several generations before you that have been struggling with this. And I think it's good to know, because the truth is the world is getting very competitive. We have a lot of competition. They don't live here necessarily. They may be in Beijing, they may be in Mumbai, they may be in Brazil. And you're entering a world that has become much more competitive than the world that I started in, because we lived in little silos and we weren't really exposed as much to what was going on abroad. And it's important to know what you're dealing with and to know that you've got a lot of competition, and you can't do enough to prepare yourself and understand how it is that you got to sell yourself when you're looking for a job. And you know, folks out here are more attuned to this, but getting internships is an important part of stepping. It's an important stepping stone into jobs, and that's critical to sort of start think about what you want to do. So let me just give you a quick idea. I view, you know, what do economists do for when you work for a bank? You know, if you work for a university, it's clear. And I honestly was torn. Do you teach or go work at the Fed? My issue was, when I looked at the Fed, I looked around and I saw 200 people with the same kind of training as me, with the same interests. When the offer at Virginia Polytech, it was going to be me. I'm the only one in my area. And when you're teaching, it's very hard. The big challenge is to get a network of people who can read your papers and you can network with and communicate with. So the Fed was a very interesting place, because it's at the center of a lot of what's going on. And it has an important role. It plays an important role in the economy. And it's important to understand some of those issues. So the way what I do at the bank, I view economist job. We are kind of detectives. Our job is to look at the evidence that's on the floor and try to figure out, narrow the list of suspects that could have been involved in the incident you're trying to solve. And the truth is, there's a lot of data and there's a lot of opinions. And if we, my job as an economist in my bank is to look at the data, and try to come up with an explanation that can fit the pieces most accurately. And if I can narrow it down and help people understand what is it that will make my story look be wrong, it helps the people who are managing risk and dealing with customers and our clients, helps them make more sense of the noise they hear, the data they're seeing. I think it's really difficult to follow the economy because the noise comes out, the economic data comes out in bits and pieces, and it's all an incoherent mesh. And it takes some time to put all the pieces together to see what's going on. So I wanna show you a little bit of how we think about things after I do a real quick rundown of what's going on globally. But first, if anyone's interested, I need to just throw out a couple ideas about, to me, an issue that I think is very confused in the public domain and what you hear. It's very common when you turn on the airwaves on a cable channel, it's very common to hear that what the Federal Reserve and these central bankers are doing is they're printing money. And that's why the stock market's doing what it's doing. That's why the economy is doing what it's doing. And it's all very dangerous because it has the potential to be inflationary. And very often in the early days of this worry, people were drawing connections between what we're doing today and the Weimar Republic. And what they meant by that is when the Weimar Republic, people refer to the hyperinflation that happened out of World War I. And we associate that moment with a central bank that was running policy poorly and running printing presses. And you can find, if you look up that era, you can find pictures of people wheeling wheelbarrows around with money because it was deflating so quickly. So here's the problem. We learn in school that the way central banks manage the economies, they buy assets, they buy securities, and they pay for it by creating reserves. And then you're kind of left to figure out how this happens, but you're told that by magic, this all turns into money, and the relationship of money to the reserves the Fed creates is related to the reserve requirement. So there's a multiplier. Most people are just told this is sort of a mechanical process. You don't have to worry about it. Fed creates the reserves, and then it turns into money by magic. And in fact, if you read the Wall Street Journal back in June of 2009, you read a story that Art Laffer had, an editorial, an op-ed that Art Laffer wrote, and the gist of the article was, prepare for rising interest rates and rising inflation. And he had a picture in there of the monetary base. And that's the story we always learned, that all you gotta do is pay attention to what is the Fed doing and what's happening to the monetary base. He didn't finish the story, because what really happened is that the Fed buys the assets. The purpose is not really to increase the money supply. They're buying assets because they're trying to force long-term interest rates down. They buy the assets, they create the reserves, but the reserves are accumulating as excess reserves. That means they're not going anywhere. We own a big chunk of them. They sit at the Fed in their books, and we get 25 basis points for holding these reserves at the Fed. And what we should be taught when you learn this story, what you should be told is the process of creating money is a partnership with the business community, the banking community, and the Fed. The Fed puts the reserves out there, but businesses have to want to borrow in order to turn those reserves into money. So when you hear people say, all this stuff that's happening, it's all about the Fed printing money, there is no money. It's only reserves that are being created. And there is a distortion, but the distortion is not happening in the way people often see it. So, and I'll talk about that in a minute, show you how we think about it. So I really think, personally, I think the issue, there's been a lot of confusion about it, and I can understand why it makes people nervous. The truth is, what's going on in the economy, to me, of course the Fed makes a difference. Of course, when the Fed has the ability to distort interest rates and push them down and incentivize investors to move money out of cash into risk assets, that's not hurting. But the truth is, what's really going on in the economy is all about the business community and economic activity and what's happening around us, the developing economies, and what is happening to profits. And I'll show you a couple visuals to make that point. Now, briefly, let me just give you a quick tour of what's happening globally. The picture here is showing you growth trends around the world, and I'm showing you growth over four-quarter periods. And there's really one thing you have to focus on. I'm showing you the top pictures, the top line is China, then India, then all the other developing economies. The red line is the US, kind of chugging along around 2%. The Japanese economy has been all over the map because they got slammed by the tsunami back in 2011, and then there was a lot of rebuilding effort, and then now, finally, the Japanese have been dealing with damages from bubbles several decades ago. They finally, as the result, in the wake of an election this year, they're finally starting to step up to the plate and get more aggressive about doing things to get their economy moving. They've always been kind of held back, the Japanese have, by fears that whatever they do would weaken their currency, and then that would create tensions with the U.S. This has always been, for the last several decades, a constraint in what Japan does. And I think what's going on now is the Japanese have finally figured out how to communicate this. They're just trying to do what we're all trying to do. They're trying to get their inflation rate back up to something closer to 2%, where all of us central bankers have it. But when you do that, if your goal is to revive your economy and to try to get, which is what you need to do to get inflation moving up, it's going to have an impact on your currency. But you're not hearing anybody complain about this now because we understand what the Japanese are trying to do. And it's important for all of us that that an economy of the size of Japan get back on its feet, because we all are affected by when we have weak links around the world. It affects all of us, even if you don't see it. The main thing to think about here is the following. It's all about what's on that bottom line. The last year and a half, the whole global picture has been kind of a dud, because we came out of this very bad recession, and then all of a sudden the world seemed to be slowing down. And it's all because of what happened in Europe, the European crisis. We had an existential crisis in Europe, and people were worried that the monetary union that has been taking shape for the past several decades was going to come apart, because you had countries suddenly running big deficits, and investors were nervous that, gee, what if Greece leaves the union? What if the whole thing blows apart? And you can see that the light shaded line on the bottom there, Europe was growing about 2.5%, and then they stalled last year. Now, you know, Europe accounts for like a third of the world's GDP. So when you have a region of the world that goes into a stall, it's going to have a very big impact, less so on us than on India and China and the developing world, because for them, Europe is probably half of your export market. So what happened in Europe had a big impact on the developing economies, which is why a lot of them, those top three lines, kind of slowed down. The shaded area is the whole global picture, the whole global economy. This is all passing, and it's passing because in Europe last year, the European Central Bank stepped up to the plate and they said, look, we're going to do what it takes to preserve the monetary union, and believe me, we have the tools. And in that moment, the market realized that this idea that Europe was going to blow apart didn't make sense. At least the European Central Bank, they bought time, and they're giving politicians time to finish the project that they began some time ago. My feeling is, when you think about Europe, you're supposed to respect the scars of history. Europe is not just about the economic benefits that come from operating as a family. Europe's experiment is also about an attempt. It's also about politics, about trying to move away from a very ugly history, from the time of Bismarck to World War II, that destroyed 100 million people. If we had an event that destroyed a third of our population, I think it would affect the way we organize our economy. And so to me, to understand Europe, it's not going to blow away that easily. It may not make sense to people that Greece and Germany and Holland and France should be in the same family, but the truth is, it's this history that's really driving the idea that they need to work together as a family and organize in a different way. So that's for that reason, this crisis is blown away. The market sort of came to that realization, and that's why you're starting to see signs of life now. In Europe, things are starting to pick up. And I think this is why in the coming year, this is going to feel a whole lot different than it has been, because if we're right, the thin lines are showing what we as a company are forecasting for the global economy. We picture that we're sort of getting a second wind. And part of the reason for this is because the crisis in Europe is past. Now, here's, to me, what's interesting. We all in the U.S. were kind of frustrated because we went through a very bad downturn, and it feels like a slow recovery. I will tell you, it is slow, but recoveries always feel this way. And I think, you know, myself, I think the only advantage that you have getting older is that you begin to remember these moments in the past. And fortunately, these recessions happen so infrequently that people can't remember what happened. But when you're an economist and you're trying to study them and you're trying to look at what happened, what normally happens, and then when you start to remember what we said about them, I hear a lot of the same themes that I heard the last time. And, you know, so the U.S. recovery has been slow, but it always is slow. And this is one of the tragedies to me of business cycles, is that we go through life, things are doing fine, something bad happens, and we just evaporate very rapidly. Things collapse very rapidly. And then it takes many years to recoup the confidence that it takes to get the economy back on its feet. So if you look at our history, we have a long history of we contract and we slowly come back. So in a sense, what's going on is not all that different from the past. But here's what's interesting. What triggered the collapse in the economy? The craziness that went on in the real estate market, all the speculation that drove house prices to unprecedented levels and then collapsed, and it was here in the US. So what's catching people's attention is, if you compare the US experience, what's going on in the US with what's happened in Japan and Europe, this picture is showing you GDP trends in each of our regions relative to where we were in 2007. So everything's normalized. We all started off at 1 in 2007, before the recession. And there's the US, 5 to 8% now above the last peak. So it's slow, but the US is grinding out. This is, by the way, one of the reasons why the job market is doing what it's doing. Then you look at Japan and Europe, and it's beginning to change, but it's still struggling. So the question is, why is the US so successful in pulling out of this nightmare compared to our partners? It's going to take, there's a lot of interesting things to write about this. There are big differences among the US and Japan and Europe. Some of them are demographics. Some of them is, you know, we are much more, when our economy gets into trouble, we are much more aggressive in taking actions to cushion the economy and to get things moving. So what you just saw in this last cycle, the big stimulus package, the Fed's actions, there's a long history of this. We are very activist in cushioning the economy, because in our gut, we may not articulate it this way, but in our gut we know that bad times are very costly. The opportunity cost of having an underemployed economy is very dangerous. And there's an awful lot of activity and wealth accumulation and capital accumulation and saving that doesn't take place when you have an economy that's very underemployed. So, but I think there's another story that's also part of this, explains part of this. And it has to do with the way we do finance in the US. If you ask what's unique about the US compared to Europe and Japan, in the US, most residential loans are securitized. And when loans are securitized, that gives an opening, that allows the marketplace to have a say when things go wrong. And what I mean by that is, if you go back to, you know, when the market belatedly realized that the real estate values had gotten way out of whack in the last decade, and you know, when loans are securitized, we package them together and then we issue securities and investors buy them. When the market realized that there's something had gone awry here and that the value of these securities no longer was what people thought they were, that when foreclosed property happens or people walk, the value of these securities is gonna get marked down. It forced anybody who owned these loans or these securities to mark to market their books to the new reality. And so, you know, you still, when you make mistakes, you have to correct them. But if you correct them quickly, you get the problem behind you faster. Japan chose a different route, if you think about it. When Japan had all those bubbles back in a couple of decades ago, they chose not to write down banks. They chose to earn their way out of the problem. And when you choose to earn your way out of a problem, it takes a lot longer to fix the problem than if you just bite the bullet, write it down, and this is a little bit of what's holding Europe back. But so that's my, and here we are. This is comparing employment in the US, Virginia, Richmond, just to give you a little sense. I always like to look at how are we doing, how is every community doing relative to the national trend? Because for example, if a lot of what's going on right now was all about gas shale and the energy development in Texas and the state of Pittsburgh and Eastern Ohio and North Dakota, you would say, well, this can't really be a real recovery. It's just all about the energy sector. So I always like to look at how are we doing in each state, and is there evidence that we're all sort of moving in the same direction? So let me just go forward a minute just to give you the snapshot. It'll look like a spaghetti, but let me. This is what the country looks like, and for me as an economist, it's important to. You don't have to know who's who. You just have to know that it feels like we're all going in the same direction. It's not just about North Dakota and Texas. So what I'm showing you is employment at any point in time relative to where we were in 2007. So you're watching the evolution of employment as a proxy for how states are doing. No matter where you go in this country, Peoria, Illinois, San Francisco, California, Brownsville, Texas, you hear the same stories. We're watching the same things. Some states were hurt more than others by the real estate debacle. So some, like the bottom, the thick lines on the bottom are employment trends in Arizona, Florida, California. But we're all moving in the same direction. So this picture tells you, if you didn't know, that what we're seeing play out in the national economy isn't just about energy. That we're all moving in the same direction. And when you have synchronized recovery going on, that tells you a lot. So what I'm showing you here is the same thing, except I'm starting everything off in 2000, the previous cycle. And the US on the bottom, there's Virginia, the black line in the middle, and Richmond on the top. Richmond looks a lot like, as you would expect, the state. Virginia's been doing really well. Virginia is going to be affected, has been affected a little bit by the sequestration cuts because they are blanket cuts in the defense industry are affecting Virginia, Maryland, a couple other states, I can't remember, more than most people, because the industry has, you have a bigger footprint, the exposure to the military sector is bigger here. So all this tells you is that Virginia, like the national economy, is recovering, and what the picture tells you is that in the US, businesses have created or recovered 85% of the jobs that were lost in the recession. Virginia doing better than that. The job base here now is above the last peak. So let me just, I'm going to skip that a minute. Let me tell you briefly how I think about how, when you're at a bank and you're forced to help people to try to figure out where are we in the rhythm of life. Let me just give you just a couple examples of how we think about things and how I think about things. And it's very similar to what a lot of my peers do. Anyone who's been and run a business for years, or if you're an investor and you have a long memory, when you look at the US, the history of the US economy, you get the impression that the economy has an ebb and flow to it much like the motion of the ocean. It's not exactly the same thing, but it's very similar. So we have this idea that we go through good times and then we lose ground, and then we get back on our feet. Or we know that the economy, market economies move up and down. Tide goes out, the tide comes in. So when you're trying to help people figure out what's going on, where are we, is the tide beginning to come back in or not? And a lot of my, some of my colleagues, their focus is very short term, and we care a lot about what's going to happen next week or what are the retail sales going to do. I'm more interested in where are we in the rhythm of life? Because a lot of my clients are businesses. They're trying to figure out, should I be cautious now or should I be thinking forward? And so this is the way I think about it. When you're at the beach and you're trying to figure out, is the tide coming in or out? You can't figure it out by watching the waves. Waves are coming in and out all the time, right? Even if the tide's going out, the waves are rolling in, the waves are rolling out. To me, the waves, in economic terms, are like a lot of the economic data. It's very noisy. The economy is very complex. It's hard to measure all that's going on. We don't know what's happening with the small business community because there's a lot of businesses that exist today that didn't exist 10, 15 years ago. It's very hard for the government's reporting system to keep up with what's going on in the economy. So we've learned over the years as economists that the data can be very distracting. They can produce data and then they get revised. And unlike when you take an SAT exam, you take an SAT exam, they tell you, if you don't know the answer, go with your first instinct. It's often the best answer. When it comes to reporting on the economy, the first answer is often wrong. And this is, we economists, we spend as much of our time trying to reconcile different data to figure out what could be going on. And when you see disparities, that's often a clue that there's something's not being measured right. And so we look for certain clues that the reasons why they may not be picking things up. So the waves don't tell you what's going on. If you want to know about, is the tide coming in or not, you need to know where's the sun and the moon and the alignment. And so that's what I want to show you, what I look at in terms of thinking about alignment. I don't really spend that much time worrying about a lot of the data because the data come in piecemeal fashion and they get revised. But I'll show you what I mean by looking at the alignment. But by the way, to understand the equity market and how the business community operates, another similarity with the motion of the ocean. When you go to the beach, I used to like to build sandcastles with my kids. When you go to the beach, if you're at low tide and you build a sandcastle where the current reality is, you're going to get washed out. So if you're pretty sure the tide's coming in, you want to figure out where is the high tide mark, because that's where I'm going to build my sandcastle. So buy me some time. Well, I honestly think this is how investors think about the world. This is why the equity market back in spring of 2009 began to stir, because people could see little signs happening that the economy was bottoming. At first, people mocked it by saying, oh, great, the economy is less bad. But though less bad is the first clue that something is turning, because we know the economy is like that. And so it's why when investors are pretty sure that when economies tumble, it's going to start to turn, they know this long history that we have. It makes investors think about where is high tide mark? Because I got to ask myself, what is the market going to think fair value is if the economy really is recovering? And so businesses go through the same thing. Because it takes time to get projects put in place, buildings put up, you need to be able to use your imagination, think out, where are we going, what's it going to look like, and that. So even in the worst of times, you'll get people starting to think forward, starting to invest in projects, starting to buy assets. And so what you've been watching play out over the last several years with the equity market coming back, and businesses hiring and businesses investing in capital equipment, these are all the classic signs that somebody out there is pretty sure the tide is coming back in, and it's making them think forward. And it's a smart thing to do, because you know that if you're not, your competitors are, and if you're slow to this process, you're going to be behind. Now, for me as an economist, going back to the alignment, how do you figure out what's the alignment in the economy to know whether the dynamic might be changing? There's a couple visuals here I want to show you that kind of get at how we think about the economy. One is, I've always known that our cycles, we call them business cycles for a reason, they're all about the business sector. Why is that? Because it's not the consumer that causes the problem. Consumers don't trigger recessions. I don't think any of us economists can think of a time when, just out of the blue, the consumer said, I'm shutting down because I don't like it. I'm nervous. It's always about the business sector, which is why we call the business cycles. And the reason is because consumers, a lot of what we do, we economists call consumption. We have bills to pay, we have to eat, we have to pay for school, we have got medical bills. A lot of what we do is on automatic pilot. There are some things we do that are like what businesses do, but when we invest in, when we buy a car, we buy a house. We're buying a big ticket item that's going to produce benefits far into the future. But it's the business sector that you care about, because the business sector, we have shareholders, we have family-run businesses. If we make mistakes, we're in trouble. We live by mark-to-market rules. We invest in projects that produce revenue far into the future. So in order to get us to do that, you've got to have confidence that the revenues are going to be there. So when things happen that make businesses nervous, they'll postpone projects, not hire people. It's that dynamic that creates that creates these contractions and then recoveries in the cycle. So as an economist, I always knew if you want to try to figure out what is the dynamic that we're living with, that we're watching, look at the financial health of the business community. Because that'll tell you how the business community sees things. Do they have an incentive to think forward, or do they have an incentive to shut down? And what I'm showing you on this picture is one of the things I like to look at. It's showing you profit margins, after-tax profits of American businesses as a percent of GDP. And if you look closely, you'll notice the vertical bars are all the recessions. What you'll notice is that in good times, you know, you go along, everybody's optimistic. All of a sudden, things start happening. Business slows down. You'll always see it in margins. Margins start getting squeezed. And you'll notice that before we fall into recessions, very often, you've gotten some early warning sign from what's happened to profits. Margins get squeezed. Well, look what's going on now. This is very difficult. For me as an economist, who believes that a lot of the dynamic that's playing in the economy is about what our business community does, it's not about Washington. Washington is the referee, but the referees don't make the game happen. The businesses have to make the game happen. And so when I look at this, I see here's the 2008 crisis, credit crunch. We'd never seen a credit crunch like this before. Businesses get hammered. They go in survival mode. Of course, that makes it very difficult for anybody graduating in the class of 2008, because they're thinking about survival, not expanding. And what do? They fix the problem, and they restore profitability, and it's back to all-time record highs. So when businesses tell me that, well, life is difficult and nervous and they're so uncertain, my reaction is, I don't think you've seen anything better, because margins are telling you you've never seen anything like this before. And to me, what's most important about this, for me as an economist, is that this is telling me that you, the business community, face a powerful incentive to think forward, because you know that if you have the courage and you have the imagination to expand, you're going to make more money because you're already earning record margins. So to me, this is the reason why you started to see things that businesses were doing, capital spending picking up, hiring was picking up. It's the reason why the whole dynamic in the last several years has been in a recovery mode. Even though when you listen to the airwaves, there's this, we were having this big argument about, a big partisan argument, and the country's very frustrated and divided about how to go about things. But meanwhile, in the background, our business community faces powerful incentive to be thinking forward. That's the first message. The second message is, look at this picture. Doesn't it feel like a pendulum has been swinging for the past 15 years? I never learned, when I was in school, I never knew that a developed economy would ever see a thing like this happen. Because we learned that modern developed economies, the distribution of income tends to be relatively stable over time. I mean, it has a cycle to it. During recessions, it shifts around. But we're not used to this story. And I personally think this is the face of globalization. That what you're looking at here is a story about what's been happening in the global economy. And it's a reminder that something big is going on, because this is really counter to much of what we learn. So here's the way I envision it. Sleeping giants, some time ago, woke up and decided they wanted to go to work. The Soviet Union collapsed, and people look around the world and they say, who's doing well? And how do they do it? And it was in that moment, 1978 for the Chinese and later for India, that the world around us began to come to the idea that maybe market reforms, market liberalization, opening your borders, inviting the world's business community to come build operations on your shores and then sell goods in the rest of the world. Anybody who's on the front lines of that story is going to be benefiting, and I think that's what you're looking at. And this, to me, this is another reminder that the world has changed very dramatically in the last 10, 15 years, and it's the reason why things are feeling more competitive, because there's a lot of folks around who want to go to work and want to achieve living standards that we have. And just to give you an idea where this is, the way I think about this is, I look at the living standard in China and India as a proxy for where they are in this story of development and compare it to the US. And the living standard in China, India, a lot of people are doing really well, but on average, the GDP per capita of these countries is about where we were in the 1930s. And what that means is there's a lot of work to do. There's a lot of momentum behind this. This is going to be going on for several decades. And you can understand why it's happening. So to me, this is an important reason why it's kind of hard to be pessimistic. Secondly, for an economist, not only does the business community have to be profitable, but if the market recognizes it and the market responds, then in that way, the equity market is monetizing our hopes and our views about recovery. So I would have a hard time being, despite what's going on with the corporate in the business sector, I would have a hard time being all that optimistic if I didn't see the equity market responding to what was going on in the business community. So some people say, look, the stock market's at all-time record highs. This has got to be because the Fed is printing money. My reaction is the Federal Reserve is not hurting. The Fed, by forcing interest rates down, is forcing investors to take risk. But the Fed doesn't create profits. It's the business community that creates profits. It's the equity market that takes its cue from what businesses are doing, what profits are doing. So what I've done on this picture, I'm showing you the broad index of the stock market, the black line, it's the Wilshire 5000 index. And I've structured, and the scale is on the left-hand side, and the green shaded area is after-tax profits of American businesses. So it's kind of another version of what you saw in the previous picture. Scale's on the right-hand side. And I've drawn the picture so that the price-earnings ratio for the Wilshire 5000 index roughly matches the historical average of 10.6 times. And I excluded the 1990s, because the 1990s, the market, the IT revolution that was going on, multiples got way out of whack because the market tends to anticipate things. So you want to take out a moment when the valuations got a little out of whack. And so what I'm showing you is when the black line is close to its historical price earnings ratio, it'll be right on top of that green shaded area. And the point of that is to show you that what's going on in the equity market is, of course, the Fed doesn't hurt, but what's really going on is the equity market is responding to the profitability of companies, and it's not so adventurous. And this is the reason why when Ben Bernanke went to Congress, I think it was about 6 months ago, and they asked him, aren't you creating a new bubble in the equity market? And Ben Bernanke's response was, you know what? The equity risk premium is kind of below historical norms. It's another way of saying the market is not really that out of line with the earnings fundamentals. And so to me, we don't all own stocks evenly. It's disproportionate who owns stocks, but when you have things like this happening, it is monetizing expectations about a recovery, and it's the reason why you're seeing it's real. It creates wealth, and people do respond to it, and it's an important part, what I need to see to believe that there's any hope that we really got a real recovery going. Thirdly, what I really care about is what's going on in the job market. Here's what's interesting to me. We get a lot of data, comes out, bits and pieces. It takes a long time to put the puzzle together because retail sales are only part of the story, government spending part of the story, business spending for equipment part of the story. And a lot of the data that we get is not reliable. It gets revised a lot, it's very noisy. But there is one piece of information that is very interesting. And if you ask me, if you told me, you're not allowed to look at anything other than you can only look at one thing to make a judgment about what's happening in the economy, what would it be? I would tell you, and I think most of my peers would tell you, most of us who've been at this trying to figure out how you make sense of the data that come out, we would tell you, watch applications for unemployment benefits, jobless claims. And I'll tell you why. No matter where you live in this country, if you live in Peoria, Illinois, or Richmond, or Seattle, or Petoskey, Michigan, if you lose a job, you go file for unemployment benefit, and I see you 1 week later. I see who you are, and there's nobody, we're not making any guesses. We don't make any estimation for parts of the economy that we can't measure. This is the actual count, the black line here. Black line is weekly jobless claims, and the scale's on the right-hand side. It's upside down, inverted, so that when layoffs go down, that black line goes up. And when that black line goes up, it means good. That means things are getting better, but layoffs are coming down. Now, what's interesting about it is it's the actual count. It's not an estimate. It's the actual count because all businesses belong to the unemployment insurance system, and that means whoever got laid off gets to go file for an unemployment benefit. Secondly, it's very timely information. It's what happened last week. I still don't know what really happened to the economy in GDP terms in 2009 because we're constantly revising these data for a long time. We just went through one of these. And the point is, 100 years from now, when people look back, If this chart ever gets looked at 100 years from now, they will see the same black line. They will not see the same shaded area, which is GDP growth over four quarter periods. So I pay attention to what layoffs are doing because they're very connected to the economy. When the economy shutters, layoffs change. And you know, when the government was shut down, by the way, I look at the state data too. You know what states saw applications for unemployment benefits jump up? Well, Virginia, Maryland, the states that were very affected by the shutdown and the government, the contractors who were doing work for the government. So, but if you had watched this picture for the last 2 years, you would have realized what all of us economists who study history know, that when economies stumble and they start to get back on their feet, recoveries have a mind of their own. They don't really care what Washington is saying. They don't care what businesses are saying. I'm nervous about this or I'm nervous about that. There's a dynamic that starts to get underway. And if you know that's the story of the American business cycle and you're watching jobless claims steadily come down, you would know that there's a recovery underway and layoffs are now back to normal. And that's the first sign, that's what you need to see to believe that we're actually moving forward. That doesn't mean that we're there yet, and in fact, if you look at the job market, we still have about 4 million people who are actually looking for a job, they're called unemployed, who need jobs in order to, before we can get the unemployment rate down to 5%. There's a whole bunch of people, 3 to 4 million people, who kind of vanished, did something else. They're under the age of 40. They probably didn't leave the job market because they thought the next thing they're going to do is retire. So they're doing something else. And it takes time to get them all back in. So as positive as these trends are, what's going on with the business sector, what the equity market is reflecting, what you're seeing in the behavior of layoffs, there still is more work to do. The economy probably is only about halfway back to where we need to be, which is why inflation is not really causing the problem that everybody thought they might see. So I think what I should do is maybe stop there and take some questions, because you probably have questions, and see if we can pick up on things you care about. And anything goes. Anything's fair game. I didn't talk about the budget situation, but if you're interested, we can. Yeah.
Wouldn't the Fed like to see more inflation rather than less inflation?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And this, if you'd asked me when I got out of grad school, if you'd asked me, will I ever hear that thought expressed, I would have told you, not a chance. And it's a reminder that what we are seeing right now is completely unique. This is the first time a central bank is really, that we have faced the situation. The Japanese have. And so this is the reminder. At the end of the day, this is the main thing that matters. You're gonna be glad I didn't go through all these. Okay, here's inflation. So this is the first time, normally what happens when you go through these recessions, inflation comes down in recessions, but it's always been above the Fed's long-run goal. I think one of the great things that Ben Bernanke's legacies is that by telling you what their inflation goal is, they're making it real transparent what it is that's guiding the Fed. And why that matters, when I hear people say, you know what, we're going through a change of leadership at the Fed, there's all this uncertainty. And I heard somebody say, the problem is markets are always uncertain when there's a change in leadership at the Fed because we don't know what their long-run goal is. My feeling is, are you listening? Because the Fed has been telling us in the clearest possible way what it is that's guiding them. And frankly, it's not just the Fed. All central banks around the world are embracing this idea that they should aim for 2% inflation. And why that matters is because if inflation were 2% now and creeping up, they would be backing off very quickly from what they're doing. So people tend to think, well, the Fed is torn because they've got this employment mandate and inflation, and that means they're sacrificing on inflation. I don't think that's not how they think. They think, and it underscores a big difference between how the Fed runs things and how the Europeans run things. At the Fed, I always knew that the focus on the labor market is to give you a heads up on how the economy is going to be evolving down the road, to give you a heads up on how inflation is going to behave. Because we believed that when there's a lot of unemployment, when the economy contracts, a lot of unemployment, you don't have to worry about inflation. And so you look at unemployment and you sort of guide your policy by what you think is going on in the labor market because you've got an eye on where you want inflation to be. If you wait until you see inflation dropping, you're kind of late. And that's kind of the European issue. So go back, two springs ago, when the Arab Spring was happening and oil prices were exploding, headline inflation rose up because gas prices were driving inflation. The Europeans said, we have a 2% inflation mandate, we have to react. The Fed said, we think this is transitory, we're going to look through it. And part of the reason they were willing to say that is because they saw the labor market was really hurting. And so they didn't believe that with an economy with a labor market hurting that this was going to be an inflation issue, and they were right to do that. And I think at the end of the day, this is going to be the, at the end of the day, they say they have a dual mandate, but the inflation mandate is the ultimate mandate. And another way of saying this is you could completely, even if unemployment, even if you forgot about unemployment, you would have to argue that if the Fed only had an inflation mandate, all they were focused on was inflation, they would still be doing what they're doing. Because here they are, they've done all this stimulus, and yet inflation is running about 1% in their measures. And by the way, there are several different measures of inflation. CPI, this is the personal chain price index for personal consumption expenditures. We look at this, and the Fed under Greenspan went to this measure because this is more comprehensive. So it reflects, by the way, spending by Medicare and the private insurance system. CPI does not include what, it only includes what you and I are spending on healthcare, not what Medicare is spending. So this is a much more comprehensive look at the whole economy, which is why it's running below the CPI right now, because the pressure in the healthcare system is coming from Medicare. There's, you know, the government has been squeezing providers from the Medicare side. So that's why this measure is giving you a more accurate, more comprehensive picture. So yeah, this is, at the end of the day, this is what will guide what the Fed does. Right now, as the labor market continues to improve, I think they would like to slowly get away from asset purchases because this is creating distortions. It's pushing long-term rates down. But what gets them to move the short-term rate back to something more normal is going to be how this is progressing. So another way of saying this is, if by magic we get the economy back to full employment, say in the next 4 years, but inflation is running 0.5 to 1%, they will still be easy. They will badly want to keep policy on the accommodative side. And you could say, well, that's, shouldn't that be easy to get inflation back up? Look at the Japanese experience. You can't wish inflation up. And you have to have a robust economy. It comes from the growth in our economy. And a lot of things have changed in our economy that are making the economy less inflationary. One of the, just to remind people how much transformation there's been, how many people in the room know what a cola is? Cola? Not the Coca-Cola. Cola. Cost of living adjustment. In the old days, when I was in school, a lot of workers belonged to unions, and their wages were set by collective bargaining agreements. And when things happened outside, like let's say the development going on in China and India was keeping commodity prices up and driving energy prices up, your wages would reset to protect you for rising gasoline prices. If your wages are set covered by a COLA, Social Security recipients get that. Today that doesn't happen. It doesn't happen here. Most people don't belong to a union. And those who do, the teachers and the firemen and the policemen, they are not worried about getting cost of living adjustments. They're worried about maintaining the benefits that they have. In Europe, it's different. Europe, a larger percent of the workforce is unionized or has some protection. So you can understand why culturally there might be different attitudes about inflation or in the central banking community. So, The key, when you ask me about, well, what's going to happen to inflation, my first thought is, well, what's going to happen to the labor market? Is the country going to get reemployed? Because when a very low percentage of our population has a job, there's a lot of budget constraints out there. And it's very difficult to get inflation problems, which is why inflation is running as low as it is. So, the body language from this discussion ought to be that, at the end of the day, this is the important. This is the big deal. Everything else that we do and watch is really with an eye to thinking about how this is going to evolve, because asset markets everywhere are priced around an idea that central banks are trying to keep inflation around 2%. If you told me, oh, they're going to renege, they're going to aim for 4% inflation, first of all, you'd lose the central bank would lose all credibility, because they've been working for decades to get to this point. And that's why I think what Ben Bernanke did is so important, because he he helped to lock down what the long-run strategy of the Fed is. And if they change their mind, there's going to be a price to pay. Because we in the investor community, you know, asset prices have to reflect a view about inflation, and we have a strong view about what it is that this long-run goal is going to be. Yes. It's interesting. If you look, there is a lot of what happens is if you see these surveys that ask people, are you earning more or less today than you earned in your previous job? A very large percentage of the country, people say no, I'm earning less. So there's a lot of migrating down, but then there's a lot of new people coming in. It's hard to tell. If you ask me to look at the data. I don't have a chart here, but if you ask me to look at the data and confirm whether this is true, I can't see it, but I know it's there. And I think the reason is there are segments of the population that are always getting squeezed out, and there's new populations that are always coming in and doing better. But I think the issue that is getting a lot of attention is the distribution of income. The distribution of income, and you know, if you think about that picture, the profit picture, that symbolizes part of what's going on. So that profit picture tells you if the share of income going to business is expanding, that means the share going to labor is going down. There's a couple things to know about this. This has all been happening, by the way. It really, the Gini coefficients have been widening since really the last 15 years. It's kind of related. And to me, there's a couple things to say about it. Number one, it's a global phenomenon. If you look at the European experience or the Japanese experience or ours, we're kind of in the middle of the ground. And I think there's two things going on and we haven't got our hands around it. Some academic research claims that part of the issue is that we had a lot of innovation particularly in manufacturing in the last couple decades. Well, we're used to innovation. It's been going on for 200 years. But if you think about it, the innovation we've been seeing in the last couple decades, it's been sweeping. We've got everything going mobile, and the transformation in the manufacturing sector has been really quite striking. I can see it. So what some academic research is claiming is that, well, part of the problem is when you have rapid innovation, it drives down the cost of technology. That makes technology cheaper. Businesses buy it, and that technology displaces mid-skill, low-skill jobs. That's part of it. I, as an economist, have a hard time with that because, to me, innovation is supposed to be what drives our living standards. So just because there's innovation doesn't mean, to me, I learned that when I'm more productive, I get paid the value of my marginal product. And so when you look at our history, real wages tend to correlate with productivity until about 15 years ago. And then all of a sudden, it's breaking apart. So it may just, if this story is partly true, it's because it's happening very rapidly. And the labor force is having a hard time. It's kind of off balance. And it takes time to sort of normalize everything. But I think a competing view, and I think this is part of it, is when the world wakes up, particularly when giants wake up and want to go to work and decide to do it on the fast track by opening borders, inviting the world's business community to come build operations in Beijing, it sets you on a course that is you're developing much faster then you can deploy the resources that you're earning. So China is earning all this in its surplus with the U.S. is earning so much it can't possibly invest all of that, and so temporarily they're saving a lot. So every time you hear about China holding dollars, it's because they can't. There's just something out of balance, and what that tells me as an economist is that the world, because of all this development, is saving more in the aggregate than they would be when things normalize. And if the world's saving more, that means they're not spending as much, which means there's not as much demand for all the workers that want to go to work. So I think what it means is that there's these two storms kind of hitting us. Rapid innovation and all the globalization is kind of throwing us for a loop, and it takes time to normalize. It's creating a lot of stress. It's creating distress in the income distribution. And my assumption as an economist is going to be that as things normalize, these winds will start to slow down, and you'll start to see labor pay picking up and the profit share move back down. But it's a fascinating topic, and what's even more fascinating about it is we don't really know how to talk about it. It's very hard to get your hands around it. And it's creating a lot of stress. And what we do know is that we live in a democracy, and when everybody doesn't feel like they're part of the, you know, they've got skin in the game, it leads to bad policies. It leads to actions that don't necessarily help people. They sometimes make it worse. And that's the problem. But we're desperate to figure out what to do, and so we strike out thinking we see the problem and we think we're going to deal with it. But what I know, you know, in economics, the problem is it's not what you see that's the issue. You have to think about all the repercussions and all the unintended consequences that happen. And so a lot of times you see things, we do things, we think we're helping people, come to find out that we're actually hurting the very people we're trying to help. And so, you know, in this case, I think the best way to deal with this challenge is to figure out how to get people who don't have the skills retrained. There should be a lot more partnership going on with state governments and the higher education community and the community colleges, and getting shop classes put back in high school, and, you know, emphasizing math skills, because you don't turn into an engineer overnight. You've got to sort of be interested in math when you're second grade. And I think that's what I can't tell you how many businesses, clients we have, complain to me that they have really interesting jobs, but they don't have people with the skills. This is in manufacturing. Well, it's because everybody grew up until a few years ago thinking that, well, manufacturing is a dead end alley. Why do I want to be in manufacturing? My dad worked at the GM plant. He told me it was useless. But now the nature of the jobs are more demanding, and there's some well-paying jobs. And I think it's going to take time to get the workforce retrained into those jobs. I think when that happens is when you'll start to see some progress on this issue. Yes?
I'm interested in your view on the ultimate impact of quantitative easing. And the reason that I ask that is that right now reserves and short-term securities are close substitutes. But as the economy recovers and interest rates start to rise, they'll become imperfect substitutes.
Yep. You know, I think the first. Let me see if I can find this. This is a real crude way of how the people in the markets are thinking about this. Because I think, you know, when the Fed buys assets, why they do this? They did this because they couldn't get the funds rate below zero. So if you'd asked any of us economists, this is not adventurous what the Fed did. If you'd asked any of us, I got the funds rate at zero. What do I do next if I want to do more? We would all tell you got to buy assets. It's not the first time the Fed did this in World War II. They didn't need to hold all the assets because the public was willing to hold the bonds to finance the war. So, but they pegged rates if you looked at the 40s. So the way we think about this is the Fed is buying all these assets, and the purpose is to drive longer term rates down. Well, the easiest way to see what they're doing, what their footprint is to look at. This picture is showing you decomposing the, I'm actually showing you the 5x5 treasury yield. So this is what the market thinks the 5-year treasury rate is going to be 5 years from now. And the top part is the inflation premium. It's roughly, you know, 2%, whatever. The blue shaded area is the key. That's the real rate. That's the 5x5 TIPS yield. So that's the market's, that's the real rate of interest that the market thinks will prevail 5 years from now. For the next 5 years. And the reason I do the 5 years forward is to get away from, everybody thinks by 5 years from now, the Fed's gonna be done with all this asset purchases. So we're trying to figure out what is the true impact of sucking out all these assets. And what you see is the real rate went from 2.5% to zero. If you look at the real 10-year yield, it went negative. That is totally unnatural. That is, you know, for all time, real rates of interest tend to be about 2.5%, 3%. So that's to me, that is the footprint of the Fed. So what happened in May? Ben Bernanke says, you know what? We're thinking about sometime later this year, thinking about slowing down the rate of purchases, tapering. And when he'd said that, all of a sudden, the market sold off, long-term rates rose 100 basis points, the real rate of interest rose quite sharply. So, you know, if you're an investor, why do you want to own treasuries when the Fed, if the Fed is going to be done doing this, you know that in the market's mind, the market's not back to equilibrium until the real rate of interest gets somewhere closer to 2.5%. So the first thing that's going to happen is this thing has to adjust. Now, we sort of got a little bit of it in the summer. I don't think, you know, to me, allowing short-term interest rates to go from artificially low to artificially less low is not a big obstacle. So I don't think this is the big challenge. So the issue, I think a lot of people who worry about the Fed's asset purchases are trying to figure out, is there a potential for the Fed's excess reserves to create trouble if they can't quarantine them? And so here's this is what people are looking at. The shaded area, the left-hand scale, this is the monetary base. So required reserves on the bottom, currency circulation, and then excess reserves the top. And the blue and the black line is the money supply. The two are aligned so that the relationship between money and reserves is supposed to be about 10 to 1 because of the 10% reserve requirement. So it's that top shaded area that everyone's worried about. And so the problem is people think that if you've created the excess reserves and then it comes time to normalize interest rates, don't those reserves have the potential to leak out into the system and get loaned out and create money? And so my own view is that this is all going to be very benign, how the Fed does this. And one of the, there's many ways they can go about this. Number one, the regulators have a lot to say about what we do. They live in our place. I see them all the time. If loan activity started to pick up and it looked a little excessive to the Fed, my boss, Jamie Dimon, would get a call from Ben Bernanke. You know what? This is not exactly what we had in mind. And I think he would listen. Secondly, the Fed has some control over this because they pay the banks 25 basis points for those excess reserves. One reason they did that is because they figured this might be a tool they could use to disincent banks from lending the excess reserves. So if they pay us more on the excess reserves, we will not have the incentive to lend it out. Thirdly, they've already done this. They can ask the Treasury to see these reserves are all sitting in deposit accounts of the banks at the Federal Reserve. They can ask the Treasury to go out and issue however much you want, special Treasury securities, and then park the money at the Fed. They called it, I forgot what the name was, supplementary Treasury securities. So there was a term they used to it. And what it did, when they did that, it just automatically, electronically moves the reserves from the bank account to the Treasury account. The Fed has developed all these tools to drain reserves and to constrain, but at the end of the day, they need to let it run off. And I think the market's going to be ahead of them long before, by the time the Fed is selling the assets or draining it, interest rates will have normalized. And that's what the summer was about. The summer, the market knows what the distortion is. They know what has to happen. And so when the Fed says, okay, it's time to start thinking about getting out of this business, we're going to make that adjustment in the interest rate market. And so a lot of the drama has happened and will happen in the next couple legs. And the process of actually unwinding all these excess reserves is really more of a mechanical exercise that you may not ever see. Because these reserves are not really in the economy. They're not floating anything. They haven't been out there. And so it's really it's a technical issue of how they trap it or quarantine it. What they've told us is they're going to just hold it and let it run off naturally. We may never know. You know, and if they find they need to drain it, they can just start selling it. So I think the at the end of the day, what it means for markets and where markets go, in my book, always it's the state of the economy and inflation that's going to be the anchor. So as long as inflation, as long as the economy is recovering but slowly, and the Fed is anticipates that this is happening, and as long as inflation is well behaved, interest rates don't necessarily have to move out of whack. But I think, you know, one important lesson for people is because of the unusual things the Fed is doing, it's really dangerous to be holding Treasury securities right now because they are artificially low interest rates. And we should not be shocked that you know, if they move up higher. Most people in the markets think that if everything goes right and inflation stays around 2%, the 10-year Treasury yield should really kind of float closer to 4%, 3.5% to 4%. I mean, there are mitigating things. I mean, a lot of the regulations that we're doing are making credit that you get through a banking system and making it more expensive. So the Fed may find that there are things that it has to do to offset this, because at the end of the day, their mandate is promote maximum employment and 2% inflation. Yes? Good.
So students sent in this question. I will tell you, our students worry a lot about the market and market swings. They really, we have some students who invest part of our endowment, and they worried quite a bit when we came to so close on the debt ceiling. So their question, one of them is, what events do you think could occur in the next short term that would cause a major upswing or major decline in the market?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, because I was telling, you know, from my experience as an economist observing the economy, I've realized, and I never follow this rule, but I've realized that that you should worry a lot in good times. You should not worry too much in bad times. Bad times, everybody worries too much. And the fact that the Fed has to do what they're doing, to me, is a symptom that we're all too risk averse. If we all believed that the recovery is happening and there's a lot of opportunities and it'll get there eventually, investors would be buying all kinds of assets. And the Fed and credit would be growing, and the Fed wouldn't have to do what they're doing. And I think, so in bad times, why I don't worry so much is because everybody's super cautious. They expect bad things to happen, so when bad things happen, it's no big deal. The last couple of years, think about it. Did anyone ever think that we would worry about Europe blowing up? That was an unthinkable thought after all that they went through. Debt ceiling crisis, we've gone through this a couple times. Fiscal cliff. When all that stuff happened, we just kind of, you know, you can't find an echo of it in the economy. You can't find evidence that really had an impact. And we sort of got a taste of this last week with the GDP and the job report. People thought, oh my God, the government's shutting down. It's all a nightmare. It's when times are good and everybody thinks we're immune and it's perfect and nothing can go wrong. That's when little disappointments cause problems. So here's the real answer to the question. The things that we should worry about, I have no clue, because it's the things that you never thought about that caused the problem. We've been talking about Iran forever. We've been talking about Greece forever. We've been talking about Europe forever. We've been talking about budget deficits forever. We keep talking about China and there's a hard landing coming. Well, that's not going to happen. So, you know, all the things that I could list for you that are on the worry list for everybody, those things we've been talking about forever, and it's hard to believe they would be the things that trigger. And outside of a meteor strike, I don't think so. So, you know, this is the kind of thing that could throw us for a loop. What if there's a massive revolution in China? I mean, we don't understand. All of a sudden, the whole concept of a developing world emerging and raising living standards, that would throw a new idea into the market, and it would challenge all kinds of stuff that we've been thinking about. So on the negative side, it's really hard, to be honest, it's hard to think of things that we really should be worrying about, because it's the things we don't even know how to think about that are the problem. On the positive side, I can think of one thing. We just went through some chaos. Government shutdown, debt ceiling. What you should know is we will never default. That will never happen. And there are many ways, nobody with an IQ over one would ever allow the U.S. to default, because you might as well go back to the caves, because if the U.S. did default and it led to this wholesale panic about the credibility of the financial system, the international financial system is anchored by a stable, liquid U.S. market, and it would completely challenge that. And we don't have too many alternatives. I mean, the yuan is not going to be a global reserve currency for a long time. You need to prove that you can go through good times and bad times without having military coups in order to encourage investors to think that you've got a stable system. So that'll never happen. But here's what's interesting, and I think you're getting this message from Washington. The government shutdown and the threat of a debt ceiling didn't solve anything. Paying government workers 2 weeks off doesn't solve any budget deficits. And I think what's happened is, out of this tension, out of this argument, I think the leadership has realized that it's important to get back to the real debate, which is all about healthcare spending and entitlement outlook. And so they have this deadline set for them, December 13. What's really going on is, everybody knows, if you talk quietly, everybody knows that the rational thing to do, sequestration, to cut everything by X percent, isn't the smartest way to go about keeping discipline. And that our real problem is really not the deficit that you see today. Today's deficit is all about the economy. And if you doubt that, there's a picture I have that shows what's happening. The deficit is dropping sharply as a percent of GDP. It was 10% of GDP, it's come down to 4% of GDP. That's all happening because the economy is recovering. Our real issue is what lies out there in our mind's eye. They look at the Congressional Budget Office forecasts for what's coming. What they are projecting is that healthcare spending by the federal government is going to be growing steadily. It's now 5% of GDP, and it's expected to grow to about 20%, which means if we don't do anything, the size of the government would double. Now, if in this negotiation that's going on now, the conversation can slowly turn back to the bigger issue, the elephant in the room, that would be dynamite for the market. Because the market, everybody in the world knows this story, but they don't think that our government is capable of getting there yet. And I think if you saw just a tiny sign that we're willing to start to address the longer-term outlook and replace the sequestration with that, that would take some of the burden off of the short-term, the drag on the economy, and it would shift the focus to what is on everyone's mind. And let me show you the picture, because you will see this all your life. I guarantee you. Because I've been seeing it all my life. So this is the actual budget deficit, which tells you what economists all know, that there are cyclical deficits and there are structural deficits. A cyclical deficit is one that reflects what's going on in the economy. What it means is the best cure for a cyclical deficit is get the economy back to full employment, and a lot of it goes away. And that's what's happening. If you look at the black line, the deficit as a percent of GDP on the right-hand side, it's come down to about 4%. But this is the issue. And I've known about this since I was in school, which is why I chose not to go into healthcare economics, because I knew that this was not going to get solved overnight. So the shaded area is showing you the CBO's projections for federal spending for different categories of things. The black line is, up till now, is where revenues have been as a percent of GDP. I take the black line to be a signal of what the American appetite for a tax burden is. It's been about 18% of GDP for all time. So if you ask yourself, if the American electorate does not want to pay more taxes to finance growing healthcare spending, that black line stays about 18%. What that would mean is, if we don't do anything to address the federal healthcare issue, government spending would rise dramatically above revenues, and that would turn into a structural deficit. And why that matters is because there's no growing you can do. You can't, getting the economy back to full employment is not going to solve that problem. But here's what really matters about this. It's why the public debate, the national debate that we're having, isn't quite focused on the real issue yet. If you say, yes, this is an issue, we got to deal with this, because you can't have the government borrowing. In a recession, it's fine because the private sector doesn't borrow as much, but you can't have at full employment the government borrowing far more than it's taking in, because it will start to drive interest rates up. That squeezes everybody and it wreaks havoc on an economy. But if you say, okay, let's all compromise. Let's cut spending and let's raise taxes. My answer as an economist, knowing what the real problem is that would not solve the problem. That would make things worse, because you would be draining the energy of the economy and you're ignoring the very thing that's really causing the problem. And in fact, what this picture tells you, that second from the bottom line, that's the elephant in the room, what it tells you is our challenge is not really a fiscal challenge. It's a healthcare challenge. And it tells you that the smart way to go about solving the problem is to reform the healthcare industry so that we enable the industry to do things smarter, to drive technology into healthcare so that we can do things better for not much more cost. And we're not asking, what the problem is, we don't need, it's not the problem isn't with today's level of healthcare spending. The problem is if we don't do anything, what the CBO is telling us is that healthcare spending is gonna be growing enormously, and we're gonna be forced to deal with it. And by the way, this is not just a US problem. This is a Europe issue, it's a Canadian issue, it's a Japanese issue, it's an Indian issue, it's a Chinese issue, more so for China. China's population is aging the fastest. So this is really a challenge everybody faces, and none of us has figured out how best to manage the resources in healthcare. And that's really what it's about healthcare and about enabling an industry to do things better. And the basic problem is there isn't enough competition to make it happen. And none of us, you know, when you guys don't necessarily, most of you don't necessarily see this yet, but if you ever have a health issue, you realize nobody knows what anything costs. My doctors don't know what anything costs. When I go to my doctor, I ask myself, who made this deal? My company made the deal, I don't know. And how do you get us to do things rationally when we don't know what anything costs, we don't know what we can do ahead of time to prevent problems later, and it's a very dysfunctional system. And you know, the problem is we haven't figured out how to do this in a humane way. Yes? Oh. Okay. One more? Would you mind? If it were coming out of my pocket, there'd be no question, right? You know, and we don't treat.
Things are starting to change. And can I
yeah.
have
yeah.
535
copies of that, please? Sure. No, really, I mean, to me, this has always been, we've known about this for a long time, which is why, and it's hard to get the. To me, two things have happened in the last year that give you reason to think we might be moving in the right direction. A congressman from the 1st Congressional District of Wisconsin, and I always give him credit, actually said words that I'd never heard a politician say. He said, we need to rethink our entitlement system. And what he was referring to is we don't need to dismantle, something's out of whack here and we need to do something about it. Because by the way, if you're 50 or younger, you should care a lot about this, because Medicare can't exist the way it is. It won't be there for you. Second thing that happened is I don't know how it happened, the tax cuts from the last decade were made permanent, most of them, except for the top one, which removed that from the negotiating table, which allowed people to say, we're done with the tax debate. And to me, what was important about that is it said, okay, if we're serious about this issue, we now have to turn the conversation to the spending side. Because you're not gonna have the ability to raise taxes to solve part of the problem, then you have to start talking about spending. And I think the real issue is, if you think about this, this is the reason why you'll hear some people talk once in a while about a value-added tax. If we all Americans decide, we don't have a problem with this, we're gonna let it happen. Healthcare can keep growing, but we're gonna have to pay for it. The only way you can really do it is to introduce a new tax system like the value-added tax, where you get 15% of GDP. The European country, almost everybody does this. The thing is, I don't think most Americans are gonna be real enthusiastic about a value-added tax, because that touches everybody.
Great.
Right.
I want to tell you, I've got something for you. So I remembered. Let's all thank Jim Glassman.
Thank you.